Thanks for joining us on the Cultured Meat and Future Food Podcast. We're excited to have the VOW team back on this episode with Soroush and Marie Gibbons. Marie Gibbons is a well-known name in the industry. She recently moved to Sydney from Berkeley, California, to join VOW as a research scientist. As a passionate animal lover and a veterinary student turned cultured meat researcher, she joined the cellular agriculture field in 2016 in the hopes of removing animals from food production. She was granted research fellowships with both New Harvest and the Good Food Institute, and spent her graduate studies focusing on large-scale cultured poultry production at North Carolina State University and Harvard Medical School. Upon graduation, Marie joined Memphis Meats, now Upside Foods, as the founder of their media development department. There, she spent 2 years developing scalable, edible, animal component-free media for multiple species and cell types. She now works with VOW's incredible team of scientific researchers, engineers, robots, and office dogs to create delicious and exotic cultured meat products using automated high-throughput platform technology. Also joining us on the episode is Soroush. Soroush joined VOW as the head of engineering in February of 2020. He founded, built, and exited his first software company while being an undergraduate at Duke University as a fully funded Robertson Scholar. He was one of the first engineers and later engineering managers at San Francisco fintech API company Plaid, as it grew from just 15 people to 170 people, now worth over $13 billion. Before joining VOW, Soroush worked as a consultant in the alternative protein industry, doing independent research as well as consulting work supporting multiple alternative protein organizations. His goal is to bring about a food system that can feed billions while protecting this beautiful blue planet we all depend on. At VOW, he and his team create intuitive software and high-throughput robotics to make cultured meat R&D drastically faster and less manual than it otherwise would be. I had a great discussion with both Soroush and Marie, and you'll hear about life at VOW. I think we'll all be excited to travel again as this pandemic comes to an end. Let's jump right in. Welcome to the show.
Thank you, Alex.
Thank you. Happy to be here.
Oftentimes, I will talk to somebody within the industry or something like that, like a conference, or in my head, I'm specifically thinking of like a Finless Foods after hour party or something. But, you know, I'll tell them we have this future food show, the Cultured Meat Future Food Podcast, and they'll say, oh, I've totally heard one of your episodes. And I'll ask them, I was like, oh, which episode have you heard? And they'll say like, oh, the one with Marie Gibbons. And I'm like, I think you're talking about the 80,000 hours podcast. And that's not me. But a lot of people have heard that episode. And so Marie, when was that episode from?
Oh gosh, that must have been what, 2018?
2018.
Yeah, like 3 years ago.
And so that one, is, I mean, 80,000 hours, that's like super awesome podcast. And I think maybe when people think of cultured meat and they think of podcasts, maybe that's what they go to. But I'm really excited to have you on the show. And Soroush, I'm really excited to have you on the show as well. And Soroush, we've never met in person, but I feel like we have. And I was thinking as to like why that is. Do you feel the same way too?
I know we coordinated for the Cultured Meat Symposium, but I don't think we have met in person.
Yeah, we haven't met in person, but I think what I was thinking is like, how could that be? Because I've hung out with George and I've hung out with Tim, like in Australia. Maybe it was after that like CMS 20 talk that you did with George. I must have thought like I was in the room with you guys. Virtually, I'm glad that we're all here right now.
Absolutely.
So there's a lot of exciting stuff to talk about today. And I really want to start with backgrounds. I have some follow-up questions, but let's just lay it on the table. You guys can choose who can start, but give me a little bit about your backgrounds and really what you did until you got to the point you're at now.
Yeah, I'm happy to start. I grew up on a farm right outside of Raleigh, North Carolina, and I wanted to be a veterinarian due to my upbringing, crazy about animals. But the more involved I got with veterinary medicine and working with farm animals, the more I realized that I could probably have a much larger impact on their lives and the lives of future animals by pursuing a career that looked into alternative protein production. And I'm also very interested in science, specifically biology, and I decided to pursue cultured meat. So I applied for a grant with New Harvest and GFI, and I was able to get my master's funded through those wonderful nonprofit organizations. I focused specifically on large-scale production of poultry muscle, and this was at North Carolina State University. It was also at Tufts, and I finished it up at Harvard Medical School, which is a really exciting opportunity. And then from there, I decided to jump into industry and joined Memphis Meats, which is now Upside Foods, moved over to the Bay Area and worked with them in media development for about 2.5 years. And then I decided to move even further and jump to the other side of the world. Here I am now at Vow as a research scientist, and I've been here for about 6 months now.
Wow, 6 months. That's super exciting. And I feel like since Vow started, it seems like so much has gotten done in so little time. And I'm excited to dig a little bit deeper into Dew Harvest and GFI and some of your previous work. But Soroush, I'd love to hear it because I know that there's some interesting background from the software world.
Yeah, absolutely. As a little kid, I lived in a few different places, but mostly grew up right here in Sydney, Australia. I went over to the States, to the US for university. I actually went to Duke University, so not too far away from where Marie studied, at almost around the same time as well, and studied mechanical engineering over there. But I also saw a lot of potential in software and what it could do for the world. So I worked on a few different startups, some my own and others with other team members or existing startups. And I just really love that whole world of being able to create something and put it in the world and add value. And so I caught that startup bug. And that took me to San Francisco, where I joined a company, a small company at the time, called Plaid, who was building an API, essentially giving people access to financial data so they could build tools like budgeting and retirement planning. And it was only 15 people at the time, but it ended up growing really strongly. And we had a really incredible team over there. And it grew to about 180 people by the time I left. 3.5 years later, I worked as a software engineer and engineering manager there. They've grown a whole lot bigger now. They're about 500 or 600 people now on last count. And I absolutely love my time there. I learned a lot about how to build great software and great products alongside incredible people. And at that point, while I was really enjoying it, I thought, what else can I apply my skills to that would be even more fulfilling, even more important to some of the challenges in the world? And I started looking around and I actually talked to my friend Elon, who some of your listeners might know. He worked at GFI. So I think both Marie and I have GFI to thank for various parts of our career. So met Elon and he opened my eyes to some of the challenges around food sustainability and animal agriculture. And so from there, I wanted to get my own perspective, build my own perspective. So I actually went and did a whole lot of different things in the food industry, everything from working on farms in New Zealand to connecting with different food entrepreneurs to restaurateurs and just people about their kind of dietary needs and habits, and identified cellular agriculture as something that the world could really benefit from if it could be delivered to people in the right ways. I found Tim and George through that same search. I came back to Sydney here in Australia because it's honestly just a really great place to live. Met Tim and George, and at the time I was looking to see if I could use software and hardware automation to accelerate some of the cultured meat work out there. And I was thinking about doing it as an independent company, but ultimately decided that Vow, coming together as a single team to combine the best of science and the best of engineering under one roof as one team, made a lot more sense. And the rest is history. I've been very lucky to work with an incredible team here at Vow to try and make that a reality.
Cool. And so did you study computer science in school?
I actually studied mechanical engineering. I actually have never studied computer science. I've been programming since I was about 11 or 12, and I was very lucky to have a lot of opportunities to do that sort of thing in my household. But studied mechanical engineering and all the software stuff has mostly been self-taught and then in the professional world learning from peers and mentors.
How did you first get introduced to Elon?
First time would be, I think it was just through mutual friends. I really love the outdoors, camping and all those things. And we had a lot of friends who are into climbing and camping in the Bay Area. And I think I met Elon through mutual friends, and we've gone camping and hanging out and climbing together. It was just like through some networks of really good friends in San Francisco.
Cool. And that's Elon Steinhardt, right?
That's the same Elon. Yep, that's the one.
Elon, if you're listening, you told me once about this crazy vegan mac and cheese recipe that was supposed to be awesome. So I'm going to try to get that recipe from you. So for you being from Sydney, it was easy to go back to Sydney. But Marie, what was it like moving from North Carolina to San Francisco Bay Area? Is not as big of a shift from moving to the San Francisco Bay Area to Australia. So how was that experience?
Yeah, it was pretty intense, but definitely worth it. Not going to say that it was pleasant moving all the way across the world in the middle of a pandemic, but Vow did everything that they could to make the experience as seamless as possible. It was quite an experience, but coming out of quarantine into the wonderful land of Sydney, where there's no masks and there's cockatoos flying around and lorikeets, which are these like ridiculously adorable, colorful parrots, and you're walking down the streets and everybody's just like really friendly and have these great Australian accents, and it was sunny. I moved here like during the wintertime in the Northern Hemisphere, so it was the summertime during the Southern Hemisphere, and that was a really great experience. The move itself, the 14-hour plane flight, and then the 2 weeks in hotel quarantine, I could have done without. But the rest of the process, I mean, Vow also kind of, they set me up with a really fantastic visa that granted me permanent residence. And I can just live in Australia as long as I behave. I can live in Australia for the rest of my life if I want. And I can benefit from the universal healthcare and the amazing school system. So moving to Australia was definitely a big change. And I'll admit, I really do miss my friends and family. But one of the silver linings of everything that's been going on is that I've learned to connect with people that aren't necessarily around me, you know, that I care a lot about. I've been able to connect with my family and friends during the pandemic via video chat. That just became really normal. And so now that, you know, I'm 9,000 miles away, I'm still talking to them and I still feel as connected as I did a year and a half ago when I couldn't leave my apartment in San Francisco. So that kind of helped a little bit. But I would say, yeah, really there's only one downside, and it's that you're far away from home. But I think it's still really worth it here.
Now, it sounds like you had never lived in Australia before that. Is that right?
Yeah, I'd never even been to Australia.
I was there for, man, so this was pre-pandemic, but it was called Global Table over in Melbourne. And I now know to say Melbourne like Melbourne. I think Thomas King taught me how to say it that way. But yeah, I was in Australia for Global Table. I think Tim was down there too. And it was really exciting to see how at least all of these kind of key players from Australia were excited about sell cultured meat and cultured meat. And so it's really exciting to see the Vow team grow. That's one thing I'd like to talk about, is how big is the team? And two, we've seen some awesome photos from the way the office is laid out now. So tell us about how the experience is working at Vow.
So I was really blown away. Pictures do not do it justice. When I got to Vow, I didn't realize how much larger the lab was, how much larger the space was. And yeah, it's a really beautiful area with this exposed brick and this beautiful glass, and we have plants everywhere. Oh, and just recently we got a yurt, which is just so amazing. We can go and have meetings inside the yurt with like bean bags, and you can hook up your phone to the Bluetooth and listen to Mongolian chants.
So the quick story there is somebody quoted us $50,000 to build a couple of meeting rooms. And we have, as one of our company values, that scrappiness, that desire to solve problems in the best way possible. And somebody was like, are we really going to pay $50,000 for meeting rooms? The thing that was the alternative, the better alternative, was this yurt. And it's turned into a really magical space.
I love it. I try and do all of my work there. The other benefit is that the office is dog friendly. So oftentimes when you're in the yurt, dogs will also come in and hang out with you on the beanbags.
Wow. Okay. I think you're right when you say pictures don't do it justice. That sounds really cool.
We got to get a few more pictures and videos out there too. Yeah, we got to show what it's like out here.
And I should clarify, dogs are not allowed in the lab.
Yeah.
The lab is not dog friendly, but the office space is. But the yurt is also dog friendly. Yeah. But no, like when we were building the space out, we made a point to make sure that the lab had positive pressure so that people could bring their dogs into work. And that was such a big selling point for me.
Cool. Wow. And so how big is the team now?
Yeah. So we're just around 30 now, and it continues to grow. We actually had a couple people start today, but I believe we're just maybe 32 today is my best count.
32 today. Wow. Okay. Exciting. And so one thing, and having you both on here, one thing I'm really excited to chat about is the use of technology in the lab. And I think when we first started talking about this episode, we actually dubbed it the super special episode. Trademarked.
Trademark.
We got to get that on the cover photo. But tell us why the Vow office, or I should say lab, is using technology a little bit differently than the traditional lab you might walk into.
Yeah. And I think Marie and I will have really interesting different perspectives here. Marie as a scientist and myself as more on the engineer side of things. Marie, maybe you can talk a little bit about your dream lab, because I think that's the Marie's dream lab is what we're trying to build. So that might be good to start there.
So we'll have to back up to about 3 years ago when I was finishing up my master's and I had to make the decision between going into industry or continuing with what I was doing and going and getting a PhD. And I kind of took a look at what my life looked like. And I thought about my strengths and the things that I really enjoyed doing. And then I compared that to what I was spending most of my time actually doing in the lab. And the things that I really enjoy and the things that I think I'm really good at are looking into the literature and coming up with new ideas, making new connections, thinking about strategy, the best ways to make novel food products. And I found that probably about 20% of my time was spent doing that, coming up with experimental design and new ideas, different media components to try, different genes to edit. And then probably 80 to 90% of my time was spent moving liquids from one small tube to another small tube and looking under the microscope to make sure that my cells weren't dead. And these things, these activities, they were exciting at the beginning when I didn't know how to do them. But after a while, they became boring. And I also realized that honestly, I wasn't as good at that sort of stuff as, say, a robot could be. In order to create these assays and get great data out of them, you have to be extremely repetitive, really good at focusing and having a great attention to detail, which, let's be honest, those are not my strong points. But a robot can go in there and day in, day out, pipette to its heart's content, and you can believe that for the most part, that's probably going to be a lot more accurate than someone else going and doing it by hand. And so I thought to myself, okay, if I want to go do a PhD, or if I want to spend the rest of my life doing this sort of work, the dream scenario would not be me slaving over a lab bench late nights all alone with a test tube. It would be me sitting on a beach with my laptop in one hand and my phone in the other, reading literature, coming up with new components, new ideas to experiment with, and then also having a little nanny cam looking at my different cell cultures and looking at my little robots that are pipetting the media conditions that I thought would be a good thing to explore this week. Because I think that's really the best of both worlds, where scientists don't have to focus all of their energy on actually conducting these routine, honestly boring assays, and instead can be focusing all of their time on figuring out what you should be exploring next. So I guess phase one of my plan is complete. I've moved somewhere very close to the beach. We can drive like 20 minutes away and be at Bondi. Phase two is what we're working on now, completely automating cell culture, which will then lead us to phase three, which is profit.
Marie's definitely nailed exactly what the vision is. The great people we bring to VOW, the great people in the cultured meat industry, what we want them to be doing is to be coming up with great experiments, being able to think about the world's best new foods that people want to try and want to be working with, and then spending most of the time on that kind of creative leveraged work. But when I first looked into the lab a couple of years ago into this industry, that's not what I saw. And it's not what Marie saw in her labs either. We saw lots and lots of people spending a lot of time doing pipetting in the lab, waiting for heaters to heat things up, waiting for BSCs to be available, doing a lot of data entry and lab notebook taking. And from my point of view, coming from the world of software and hardware and a lot of what's been going on in that industry for the last 20 years, a lot of it felt solvable. A lot of it felt like it could be a lot better. And this is important for Marie's point of view from the creativity and the leverage, but it's also important for bringing cultured meat to market and solving the problems that we need to solve with biotechnology as soon as humanly possible, as we all know. So that's what we try to do here at VOW. The ways we do that include using things like liquid handling robots to do media mixing. So instead of sitting there adding small amounts of growth factors one at a time, reading off a small-to-read table of media ingredient formulations, a robot can do that all day long, all night long, without a whole lot of intervention and two extreme levels of accuracy, as Marie was talking about. We can take what people are doing by looking at under a microscope and do that not once or twice or 100 times, but 1,000 or 10,000 times, and be able to screen for the very best cell lines for cultured meat. So really, the engineering team here works really closely hand in hand with our scientists to take Marie's vision of an automated lab, a efficient lab, a reproducible lab, and to try and make that a reality.
Now, when we talk about liquid handling robots, you kind of get the idea from the name even, but can you guys give me, like, explain it like I'm five? And I want to preface by saying, I always hear that they're one, crazy expensive, and two, Opentrons, is that a liquid handling?
It is. Opentrons is, yeah.
Okay, it is. And those are cheaper because they're smaller open source type of thing.
Correct.
Right? So can you give us the Eli 5?
Yeah, absolutely. So a liquid handling robot is exactly what it sounds like. It moves small amounts of liquid from one location to another. So for example, your cells need, just to make it really simple, it might need glucose and insulin and albumin. So those are three reagents living in three separate containers. You can either bring in somebody with a PhD who spent their whole life learning all these things and get them to do manual labor and hurt their hands and eyes doing it. Or you can get a robot that has a little motor that can suck up liquid. It's a syringe, really. It's a syringe on a robot. So it can suck up liquids, bring them together, and off you go. You've got your media formulation. And there are dozens and dozens of similar experimental steps that wet biologists, cell biologists have to do every single day that we can program these robots with software to get rid of, to be done automatically rather than with a person sitting there doing that day after day.
That was a very good explain it like I'm five answer. And I guess to put a number to it, how many times do we really need to do that? Is it in the thousands, tens of thousands? Could there be, you know, over the course of maybe a couple of years, that have to happen millions of times?
It's a great question, Alex. I did a calculation for one of our automated protocols recently. For one of our media mix protocols, there were 400 suck up and put the liquid back down operations in making a single media, like for a single run of an experiment.
Wow. And that's just one protocol.
That was just one run of one protocol. So to be able to have all of these different medias for all of these different cell lines that we continue to optimize and make better and cheaper and more accessible for the world, we're going to be doing thousands, tens of thousands of times, ideally as many times as possible, because that's how you get to the lowest cost and best medias and the most food choices. So 400, do that 1,000 times, which is really a huge conservative underestimate of how many times a typical cultured meat company will do this. And we're talking about 400,000 times somebody is moving liquids up and down.
And I should note that this 400 times is not coming from the same vial and being dispensed at the same amount of microliters. This is all coming from multiple sources and different concentrations, different amounts. If there was any mistake, that is most likely going to happen because humans are prone to error, any sort of mistake, the way that our experiments are designed, if you make one mistake, then the entire experiment could be compromised. So there's a lot of benefit to having that extra accuracy, in addition to not forcing people's brains to turn to mush.
Absolutely. In my head, Marie, you're setting up this experiment and then telling Soroush to program the robot to do these experiments. Tell me a little bit about your day-to-day roles at Val.
Yeah, I think you pretty much covered it. I lay out on the beach and tell Soroush to...
We don't mind. We enjoy programming robots. That's what we signed up for.
But realistically, when we go into designing experiments, one thing that I think sets us apart is as we're every single experiment that we design, we go at it thinking about, okay, yes, this is experiment is important because it gets us to our goal of creating a fantastic product. But at the same time, how do we make this experiment so that it can be automated, so that a robot can do it? And so rather than going at these goals thinking, okay, we're just going to do this quick and dirty, and it doesn't matter if we have to spend 12 hours making it happen, because if we get results a week sooner, that brings us a week closer to a product. We take our time to think about knowing that this is something that we're going to be doing over and over again, because another thing that Val was really focused on is not just one species and not just one run-of-the-mill domesticated species that has a whole bunch of literature to back up how to culture the cells already, but we're hoping to explore hundreds, thousands of different species and cell types. And so going into these experimental designs, knowing that one, we're going to be repeating them over and over again using different cells. And two, we don't want to be the ones repeating them over and over again. So we think about it as how do we make this automated? And the great thing is, it's not like I'd never even heard of liquid handling before coming to Val. Everybody's who's worked in a lab has probably dreamed about being able to work with a liquid handler. But the issue is that in those situations, most of the time, there's quite a bit of an investment in one, I guess, the cost, if you want to go for one of those big guys like the Hamiltons or the Tecans, but also the time in learning how to use them and learning how to program them. And in the end, maybe some people just decide that it would be easier to just pipette it on their own, because the idea of creating protocols and writing scripts and getting the robot to do what you want is just so overwhelming on top of all of the other lab work that you're doing. But that's not the case here, because we have an entire engineering team who is dedicated to creating these protocols, creating these scripts. Basically, as long as we can tell the engineering team what we want, then the engineering team is focused on teaching the robots to do our bidding.
And I think that's probably an important difference from other biotechnology teams, other cultured meat teams to talk about. We fundamentally look at cultured meat as a multidisciplinary problem. I think if we only had engineers in the building or we only had scientists in the building, neither group could get us to cultured meat in any reasonable time frame. What we do is we say, this quarter, we really want to have a great cell line for making food in these ways or some other scientific or other technical goal. And we put scientists, engineers, and whoever else needs to be in the room as far as expertise into that one room. And we can work side by side to design the experiments, design the pipelines, to solve for the problems in the best ways possible. And I think that's been the secret to Val's success, to be able to have as big of a library, cell library as we do, to have some of these early kind of product concepts and soon maybe even serious manufacturing happening in 2 years. Which 2 years is really nothing for a biotechnology company, as anybody who's done it would know.
I think that it's actually pretty funny to think about that, because most labs would probably consider themselves pretty techie if they're not using like Microsoft Word as their ELN. And I'm really excited because what we've been talking about is collecting data and a lot of data. So what I'm excited to ask about, and this was really part of the notes when we first started talking about this episode, is how do you use that data? And we use the word machine learning. And there was, I think you guys posted something about using machine learning for cell counting and that kind of thing. But I'd love to hear about how you are using that data that's being collected, these very large amounts of data.
Absolutely. I think there's a pipeline, a specific challenge that we've solved that might be really illustrative of a lot of this. And that's been working with cell lines. Whenever you go off and get a biopsy from an animal, you're working with millions of cells. Trying to identify the specific cells that would grow best into the meat products that we all love and want is actually a massive challenge. So one of the pipelines we've established there is really illustrative of this. So we take that biopsy and we put it through a single cell sorter to sort those cells into single wells. And we've developed on the engineering team alongside our science peers an automated scanning microscope. So it used to be the case that people would look down a microscope and scan in a well, in a 96 or a 384 well. Where is that one cell? And you're just squinting your eyes, you're arching your back, you're doing this for hours at a time looking for these cells. And then you would do that every single day to watch those divisions happen. And then you would say, okay, which one's doing well, which one's doing poorly. And the very first time we tried this, we literally only looked at three or four clonal cell lines. We only looked at three or four wells of cells, because that's how much work it took for our scientists to have to do this. And we knew that we were never going to find a great cultured meat cell line this way. So what we did was establish a new pipeline. So we used an automated scanning microscope that scans every single well, corner to corner, every single day, actually does an entire plate in about 10 minutes instead of an hour for a person under a lot of pain. And once that comes through, we take that massive data set of all of these images and we put it through a neural net, so a specific type of machine learning model, to be able to count up the cells and tell you, these are the wells you should be working with. These are the wells that are most promising. And with that kind of engineering and that kind of automation, we've been able to go from those three to four clonal cell lines per run of these biopsies to about 12,000 today. And we're not done. That 10,000x improvement is just the beginning. We can do better than that, and we can go further with how long we watch these cells and their properties. So that's been one massive area where the engineering and science team have been able to contribute really massively to the speed with which we can bring cultured meat to market.
During the CMS 20 talk, I think you guys highlighted that when there's like a new image taken, for example, it's immediately uploaded to Slack. I guess my question is directed towards Marie. One, how closely do you work with Dr. Ryle, so Dr. James Ryle, and also how have the collaboration tools that Vow has put in place really helped you collaborate better?
Yeah, so I would start off by answering your second question first. I don't know if there is something in the water. I have never worked with such a ridiculously cooperative, kind, and empathetic team. Maybe it's just an Australian thing, but everyone here is just so ridiculously kind and compassionate and eager to help, eager to learn. Just the other day during a presentation, I was updating the team and then I pointed out that I was struggling and I was worried that I may not be able to hit one of the goals that we have. And just immediately, at least four different people jumped up, well, not jumped up, but spoke out and said, oh my goodness, okay, what can we do to help? I've got some extra time here. I've got some extra hands here. Honestly, I think that the culture just, it makes communication and makes cooperation just really easy. We don't even have to try because everybody's just so focused on succeeding as a team. And then regarding your first question, how often I'm able to work with James, that's multiple times a day where we're Slacking, we have meetings together. And that's a really great feeling to be able to have such close communication with the CSO of the company. And James is not only invested in the company's success, but he also offers a lot of advice and a lot of support for my own personal growth within my career. And I'm sure that's something that he does with others within the company. So it's great to have such a supportive CSO that I can talk to quite a bit.
I got to put in a plug for the episode with James, because now I haven't been to an airport bar in a long time, but every time I think of being in an airport lounge or bar, I think of his story of when he's just like, you know what? Let's do it. Let's join Vow. And it was a good story. So if you haven't tuned in, check it out. That's really cool. And I think oftentimes, like, you hear stories like this and you think like, how is this not happening more in this industry or other companies? But it's actually very rare. And I think some startups get it. Some startups build their theme on culture. I think Airbnb is one of those companies that has been known to do that. And then it's exciting to see that you have that there and are also close to Bondi Beach.
Great culture, great beach.
I also would like to make a plug for the episode that you have with James, because interestingly enough, that is what sparked the initial connection. After hearing that episode with you and James, I decided to reach out to James, and now I'm here. So thank you very much for initiating that.
I love it. Hearing that you are a listener has made my night. You guys are in the daytime. I'm a day before. I'm at nighttime. So you've made my night.
That's amazing, Alex. Yeah, huge thank you. I mean, I listened to your podcast before I ever joined Vow. So it's been a big part of my journey as well. And now hearing Marie found us through you, we have a lot to thank you for.
It's super exciting. And I think, Marie, just a few minutes ago, when you were talking about that story about how everyone is so kind and friendly, it reminds me of one of the first calls I had with Tim. He was at like his old job. He like snuck away into a closet or something to have a call about cultured meat stuff because he was at his old job. And he was just so excited and driven about it. I think that I see that in you guys too. And I saw that in James too. When we're talking about culture, it really does resonate through the whole team. And I think that's important. And maybe I got to get a yurt. I don't know.
Yeah.
Highly recommend it.
It's been a big part of our emphasis. If we bring the right types of people into the building and give them the right environment, then that's what's going to create magic. We don't know what's going to work for cultured meat, but if we bring the right people and create the right culture, the rest can happen. And even our ability to collaborate as scientists and engineers with really different backgrounds, or our ability to work with people of all kinds of different seniority levels and all this stuff, effectively comes down to that culture that Tim, George, and many others in the organization have helped build here at Vow.
I want to step back a little bit and talk about personal motivations about the industry. And so instead of just directly asking the question, I want to ask it in a super special way. Have you guys been to Alibi Bar and Kitchen?
It sounds super familiar. Why does it sound so familiar? Is it in San Francisco?
No, it's in Sydney. Okay, so I think it might have been to me. You know, maybe it was somebody from Global Table. I don't know. But what I wanted to really ask is, Marie, I know that you're plant-based. Is that right?
Yes, vegan. There's a difference.
I like to ask plant-based because sometimes I'll ask somebody, if are you vegan? And then they'll say, oh man, I didn't know, but that coffee actually had some creamer in it. Or like people are like really tense up. But so yeah, plant-based is less than, I would say, vegan. So you are vegan. Soroush, are you plant-based?
I'm not sure about plant-based because I'm not sure the right definition of that one. But I have reduced my animal product intake dramatically, but I'm not strictly vegan, no.
Okay. And the reason I ask is I want to know about some personal motivations. Like oftentimes we hear of the big three. So animal welfare, environment, and just human health or personal health. It doesn't have to be any of those three, but I'd love to hear what are your personal motivations.
Yeah. Funnily enough, I was thinking about this yesterday. I'm not even sure what triggered it, but I think for me, it's really simple. So I love getting out into nature. I love camping, hiking, going to conservation parks. I love the world, the beautiful nature in our world. And I want future generations to be able to access that just like I can. And at the same time, I also have strong cultural connections to the food I eat. My family is Iranian. Australia's also got some really interesting food cultures. So that's really important to me as well, the food cultures, which obviously much of it revolves around animal products. And so my dream for the world is that we can preserve the beautiful planet and nature that we have while still being able to foster and even expand and grow the culinary culture that we've got in the world today that's so beautiful and rich. So if we can keep both those things alive and prospering, that's the dream that I work towards here about.
I love it. And Marie?
Yeah, I would definitely agree with Soroush. And I would also say that I do care very much about public safety and the environment. But in the end, the thing that really gets me up in the morning and keeps me up late at night and just working really hard, even when I'm tired and want to quit, is definitely the animals. Definitely the hope that what we're working towards will be able to make this world so much better for them. I've had a lot of really terrible experiences. And in my past life, working in veterinary medicine with farm animals, I was exposed to the things that you normally only see in the PETA videos, the things that I didn't think really happened, because how could that sort of stuff even be legal? And it's not like anybody enjoyed it. Everyone who was involved, they were doing it because we felt like it was a necessity. Nobody wakes up and is excited to go rip testicles out of baby pigs every day. But it's something that our society has just started to demand over time. We want cheap meat because it tastes good and it's good for you and it makes you a bigger, better, stronger person. And it's something that if we can create that without having to hurt animals, then I will have done my job.
I'm going back to that 80,000 hours podcast. And yeah, I can't think of that example you just gave of ripping out testicles. And I remember you saying that it's literally ripped out, not cut. Otherwise, there'd be too much bleeding or something like that. And I think learning more about that, and I think this generation is learning more about that. And it's really an eye opener.
You just don't think that sort of thing. You think it's something that the vegan mafia is making up these conspiracies because in the end, we're going to profit from people eating more plants. It's not something that we're making up. It's just something that we've seen behind closed doors and we wouldn't believe it unless we saw it. And these undercover videos, they're real. These practices happen because people have to squeeze pennies in order to make the margins that they make. So you can get your cheap dollar burgers at, you know, the fast food restaurants. And I think a lot of the times the farmers have to decide between, do I give pain medication to the animals before I castrate them or do these literal body alterations, or do I save up money so I can feed my family? And it's just a terrible situation for everyone involved. Again, it's not something that anyone enjoys. And I think that if we can offer solutions that involve people being able to raise animals and take care of them, if farmers had the opportunity to raise cows or pigs and not have to kill them in the end, but just have them because they enjoy being with animals, then I think everybody would be a little happier, especially the pigs and the cows.
Yeah. Well, we're applying technology to solve those problems, and I can't be more excited for that. What is really the best way to get in touch with each of you? Oftentimes I say LinkedIn, maybe it's Twitter or something else. What's the best way?
I think LinkedIn works just fine. Reach us out. I'm Soroush Paul.
And Marie Gibbons.
And you can find us both on Val on LinkedIn. Yeah, so that's the best way to reach us.
Awesome. And we'll add those handles into the show notes. Are there any last insights or announcements for our listeners today as we wrap up the conversation?
We've got a couple that we're hoping people can help us with. So firstly, we've got a large number of open roles where we need the smartest and best and most passionate people around the world to help us. Four that we'll call out today. We've got software engineer roles for people who want to write software to accelerate this and solve some of the hardest, most challenging problems in software and hardware automation. We've got a research scientist roles to do the world's best science here towards cultured meat, including some incredibly interesting and novel scientific challenges. We've got a food inventor role for people who love the culinary world, who love food, who want to invent the future of food, our first food products. And we've got a bioprocess scientist. So if you want to scale up bioreactors and bring big scale mammalian cell culture to the world as cultured meat, we'd love to hear from you. And then the last one I'll touch on my end, then I'll hand over to Marie for a couple. If you have any expertise in biomanufacturing, whether that be scaled up mammalian cell culture or managing contract manufacturing, I'd love to hear from you. So definitely reach out.
Yeah. And on that note, Val is eager, very eager to help with support in moving, support with relocation, visas. I think we've got 5 internationals on the team that have all come through this really great.
Who brought partners and others.
Absolutely. Well. Dogs. So if you're interested in working on the beach. Oh, also something I forgot to add. Val is also within like a 5-minute walk of a chocolate factory. And when it gets hot out, we're also within like a 7-minute walk of this amazing ice cream factory. So most of your meetings are going to involve like ice cream or chocolate or like hanging out in yurts with dogs or, you know, beaches. And I would say that the roles that Soroush just mentioned, those are ones that we're specifically looking for. But anybody with any sort of background, we would love to hear from you. As long as you're passionate, you're motivated, and if you think that you have a skill set that could be applicable to what we're doing, please reach out. I mean, the worst thing we can say is no. Get in touch.
Cool. And that's valfood.com/careers. I just logged on to that and I saw some awesome graphics that Tim put together. I forgot who the illustrator was, but if you haven't checked out the blog post about the branding for Val, definitely check it out. The design geek inside me is excited to share that. Thank you both so much. This was awesome. I think that there's definitely a lot more we can cover, but I'll let that be for a future time. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Alex.
Thank you so much, Alex. And we really appreciate you taking time to chat with us and share our story as well.
Been such a pleasure.
This is your host, Alex, and we look forward to seeing you on the next episode.
This program was produced by H Media. We'll see you soon.